So here you see my measurement setup, and here I have cables lying around. The one that I have over here now is 6 meters, and there is a 10 meter cable lying over there. My analyzer is down here. I will turn it on when we need it. And for the rest, what I have here is a signal generator. And the signal generator is at 1 megahertz, and it splits. And there's a power splitter over here, and that splits the signal into two lines that are equal. One of it goes directly into my picoscope with a termination of 50 ohms. And the other one also goes in the picoscope, but I can connect my connector, my cable to it. And my cable is 50 ohms. So at the moment, when I look at my picoscope, you will see, you'll see that I have a green and a blue signal. The blue signal is from the side that is the reference that goes into the 50 ohms. Yeah, and the other one doesn't have the 50 ohms, so it is twice the size. But then I will connect my 50 ohm cable to it. But maybe the first question will be, you're saying the cable is a 50 ohm cable, you could say. So where is the 50 ohms? So I got myself a multimeter. And this is the multimeter with a coax adapter. And let's connect it to the coaxial cable. And you see the meter doesn't say 50 ohms. And now I can switch my meter to capacitance measurement. And what does it say? It says it sees a capacitance of 6.4 nanofarads. So now we might
640 pf.
Yeah. So the question is, how can that be? We are telling it's a 50 ohm cable. Where is the 50 ohms? Well, now let's see what that means, and I will go to my other image with the oscilloscope there. So I will connect now my cable to the oscilloscope. And look what we see happening here. So you see for a short period, it looks like the cable is 50 ohms, and then something funny happens. And when I use my cursor, then I can see the funny thing happens with about, what is it, 63 nanoseconds. And what I can do some kind of, I can do a calculation with that. And for that, I will share my screen again. And I put some tables here. And if you look in the left table, then you see here 61 nanoseconds. And you see a whole calculation where I have calculated the speed of light in the cable. Light is slower, the light speed is lower in the cable. And my cable length is, you see 6.1 over here, which means that it takes 31 nanoseconds for a wave to travel into the cable. And then apparently something happens, because after 61 nanoseconds, I get this bump. So it looks like something is reflecting at the end of the cable and is coming back over there. And I said my cable is 6 meter, and you see 6.1. And how come? But that is because there is 10 centimeters of connectors to my cable. But what I can do now is connect 50 ohms to the output of my cable. So here I have my cable again, and I have a 50 ohm resistor. And I connect it. And now you see, everything is perfect again. If I shift it, they are on top of each other. Here you see the pulse that is going in and going out. If I remove the 50 ohms, you see a reflection. And this is at the other side of the cable. So apparently 50 ohms is not a resistance of 50 ohms, but it is the relation between the electric and the magnetic field in the cable that is traveling to the cable. And in the beginning, if the cable would be infinitely long, then the field would go away. You would never see it back and you would see 50 ohms, like you see in the first 60 nanoseconds of the cable. But then the wave bounces and comes back. And you could say basically then the message comes that there is no 50 ohm at the end of the cable. So it takes that time to do it. If I would short the cable, I can also do that. I have a little short circuit. Then I get another type of reflection. You see it reverses. So for some time it seems the cable is 50 ohms, but then you find out it is zero. So you see it's important that the cable is terminated in the right way. Now let's, for example, put 75 ohms in there. I also have that, then you see. If I have 75 ohms, which is nearly correct, then you see I have a little bump and you can see where it is. So now I have my cable open again. And what I can do now is I connect my 10 meter cable to it too. So I take my 10 meter cable and connect it to my 6 meter cable. And you can see the cable has become longer. But if I terminate my 16 meter cable with 50 ohms, it's perfect again. So it is very important to do that. Now I can do something else. So as you see, I have here the 50 ohm side of the cable and I have at the other side, I have my 50 ohm. Now I remove the 50 ohm at the end of the cable, but I'm not only going to do that. I'm only also going to change the impedance here. And I got myself another 50 ohms that I can put in series with the cable, which means that now the cable is not driven from 50 ohms, but from 100 ohms. And now we get to see this. You see some kind of a staircase. So apparently the signal bounces, but now bounces also at the side of the generator. It goes to the other side, it bounces again. And of course, every time you lose something in the resistor. So what you see here is something that looks a little bit exponential. And actually what you see happening here is a discrete version of the capacitor that the multimeter was measuring. So if the frequencies are low enough, then you get the capacitive behavior. So you see here how the Lund model with reflections and so on gradually would transform into a compact model. So now I will take off the long cable. And you see, now it already starts looking like an exponent. So that was one measurement that I wanted to show to you. So I'll get the 50 ohms out of the chain. So now I have my one reflection again, but now I will turn on, sorry about the noise, I'll turn on my analyzer. And here's my measurement setup. So I'll take my cable, I connect it to the 50 ohm measurement channel, of a 1 mega ohm measurement channel. So this is 1 mega ohm, this is 50 ohm signal generator. So it puts a signal in there, and here with a high ohmic input, I'm measuring what happens. And when I put it in here, here you see the impedance of the cable now to find the other end. If I terminate it with 50 ohms, then you see I get a straight line from 0 to 40 megahertz. So the cable behaves like a nice 50 ohm resistor. If I leave it open, then you see I get dips in the frequency. And this is very inconvenient. For example, if I wanted to do a measurement at that frequency, and you can see it is at, if I look at the marker, about 8 megahertz, 8.2 megahertz. That's not a really high frequency. So it's not like, oh, the frequencies are that high that it doesn't make a difference. And if I short the cable, and of course, at zero, you see now 0 ohms, and then here you see the short again. If I terminate the cable with 75 ohms, there's also a frequency-dependent transfer. And of course, that can be very inconvenient if you want to do accurate measurements. So what we see here, that if we want to have a long cable, and let's make it 16 meters now. So this is the 16 meter cable. You can see how important it is to terminate it with 50 ohms. So this is 16 meters. And this is 16 meters terminated. So it is very important, as you can see. Let's turn off the noisemaker. So it's very important to make sure that the termination of the cable is correct. If you look at this screen, you can see in the table for the different lengths here for 16 meters, you can see that the return delay is 162 nanoseconds, which is a lot, which means that for an open cable at 3.1, you have this resonance. And if you short it, you have it at 6.2 megahertz. So this can be, and of course the cable from the ground station to the antenna is longer than this. So you can imagine that it is very important that when we make our antenna amplifier, that at the output it has 50 ohms. Otherwise we get reflections, we get standing waves, and then our cable starts behaving like a filter. If we terminate it in the correct way, it will be okay.